Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger, and today I want to talk to you about how do you get published? How do you publish your work if you are an amateur research mathematician? So, what does that mean, first of all, being an amateur research mathematician? Well, it probably means that you're not at an official university or college, you're not a member of a research group associated with a corporation. Perhaps you have a bachelor's degree, perhaps you're an engineer, perhaps you're just a retired person and you're working, you perhaps discovered something and you would like to get that out there. So we're going to talk today about how one overcomes the natural challenges that you're going to be meeting here. So the challenges are considerable and I think you benefit by having the right attitude towards them. So the first thing perhaps to say is that the standard official publication direction that a professional is going to be looking for, namely to publish something in a journal or to publish a book, these are largely very difficult for you to break into. And you can waste a lot of time and get very frustrated by sending your, fancy, exciting new development to various journals and having them knock you back, perhaps even without seriously looking at it. And you may also try to send your work to professional mathematicians, asking them to have a look at things. So I get quite a few requests like this, people sending me stuff and saying, please look at what I'm doing. It's really interesting, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to appreciate that from the point of view of a professional mathematician, we are, very busy. We have lots of things on our plate. We are very reluctantly going to, spend more than 10 minutes, to be honest, okay, looking at something, unless it attracts our attention, almost immediately. And we can usually tell, not always, but we can usually tell within just the first 30 seconds whether this paper has the potential of actually being serious or in the sense of, having perhaps something interesting to say. So, why is that? Well, because pure mathematicians, they write in a certain way. Okay, they write in a way that's concise, that's to the point, and there's not a lot of fluff. So that's something that that amateur mathematicians often get wrong. That they think that they have to start with some explanatory prose about their situation or or the struggles that they've attained. They're telling their life story here. That's not what you want to do. Okay, that will immediately make your work disregarded. So what you want to aspire to is writing something that's to the point, that has a principal aim, objective, and you should be able to explicate what that objective is in the first paragraph. So in the first paragraph, it should be clear which direction you're going and what it is that you actually accomplish. But even if you do send something like this to a professional mathematician, you are very likely going to be ignored or receive some polite dismissal. So I'm here to tell you what you perhaps should strive for, okay? In the modern world, the publishing landscape has changed dramatically from previous decades. There are now lots of opportunities for people to publish things essentially on the web in some fashion or another. And this is a viable alternative that you should be thinking very clearly about. Okay, it should be almost first and foremost in your mind is to put what you have got up on the web somewhere where people can find it who are interested. What kind of things are we talking about here? Well, there's two things that come to my mind principally. First is having a blog. So it's easy enough to create a blog, use WordPress or many other frameworks, and you then can write up something, and you can put in pictures and diagrams, and so you can explain what it is that you're explaining on a blog. And if you do this nicely, then you can hope that people who are interested in that topic will find you, that search engines will ultimately pick you up. Now that's still not easy to do. So there is also a second possibility, which is to create a short video, notice I say short, a short video that explains what you're doing, hopefully with a pictorial aspect, a visual aspect. Certainly less than 5 minutes long. Anything more than 5 minutes, and I think you're dooming yourself. Okay, you want to have it less than 5 minutes. That should explain what's going on. And I think if you have accomplished something interesting, you can aspire to do both of those things, to create a little blog and then to create a corresponding video that supports and explains what's going on. So how should you write this? Well, you should focus on one thing. Okay, you should think, well, what is the most important thing that I have accomplished here? Okay, so there may be lots of things, but try to focus on the most important thing and try to identify it as a theorem. Okay, so in your mind, you have to very clearly find out what it is that you've actually proven or discovered. And you want to be able to state that really clearly. But you want to make sure that the notation that you're using is defined, and that you're using standard notation. You know, if you're using your own vocabulary, then you're obliged to spell out what the meanings of these various words are. Hopefully you're not doing that too much. But if you are going to introduce new terminology, you have to say very clearly and concisely, you know, what it is that the words mean that you're using. And then there should be the main result. And then I think, generally speaking, you want to illustrate that. Okay, before you get into the details of a proof or an explanation, you want to illustrate what it is that you've discovered with a nice diagram. That's a great way. If it's something geometrical or analytic, you know, you can use geogebra in a number of ways, calculus results or polynomials. You can use some pictures to illustrate discrete math. You can have, of course, diagrams for geometrical things. So you want to illustrate what's going on and give some examples. Okay, and if what's involved in your work is also a proof of something, well, then you should have a proof, and hopefully it should be really concise and that you've really spent time working through and getting the most efficient and precise description of the argument. And my advice to you is don't go over like 3 or 4 pages. You know, that's probably enough. You know, to try to say what you have to say in 3 or 4 pages at most, and illustrate what's going on with diagrams, and then put that out there as a blog. And if you're unsure what you know, the reception is going to be, ask your friend, you know, to read it and ask him, does this make any sense? You know, and if he says or she says, well, actually, I don't understand anything that you're saying, then probably you haven't explained it well enough. Okay, so that's one thing you can do. You can actually create a blog, and it doesn't have to be, you know, 3 pages long. It can be just like one page where you've discovered one little interesting thing, and you just want to explain that one little interesting thing. Now, there's one more addition that you need to put in and to spend some time on, and that's that you want to connect to the existing literature. So you want to position whatever it is that you've done in the context of other people's work. And if you don't do that, then that's the surest indication to a professional that you're not to be taken seriously. I'm sorry, but that's the way it is. Okay? If you haven't bothered to find out what other people have done in that area, and you haven't acknowledged those other people's efforts and how their results or insights are, you know, connected with yours, then you're not going to be taken seriously. I'm sorry. So there's some legwork there that has to be done. But these days with computers, that's not too hard. You can actually just Google things, and you Google certain areas, and you actually start looking through those papers and looking at the references in those papers and get those things and skim those and see what things are known that are relevant to what you're trying to explain. And often what will happen as you do that is you may discover that, hey, actually, what I thought was novel has actually been discovered already before. Don't be overly discouraged if that happens to you. That happens to professional mathematicians all the time. Okay, it's part of the trade. It's part of the learning experience of moving forward towards the boundary of knowledge. Okay, so, but that's something that you are obliged to do. And so there should be some references, but they should be relevant. It's not just references that you're putting in there to pad the thing out. They should actually be really relevant to what it is that you're trying to explain. Does that sound like a lot of work? Yes, it is a lot of work, okay? Even if you've proven just a very small or discovered a very small little result, I think it's still a week's work, okay, to create a nice blog that explains it and that positions whatever you're doing in the context of other or prior work. So that's, I think, a really potentially, you know, useful direction to go and something to think about if you're an amateur researcher, okay? It's not getting published by some famous journal, but you're just putting it out there, and then your paper or your blog will potentially get some reads, and people may contact you. Maybe you will generate some interest and some discussion with other people. That would be great. On the video side, if you have something, a topic that you think can be displayed nicely, visually, that's a very powerful way of proceeding. And again, I would suggest conciseness, maximum 5 minutes. Make sure that you start by, you know, introducing yourself very briefly, okay, like, you know, less than 30 seconds, probably less than 15 seconds. I'm an engineer. I've been working for, you know, Bell Labs for the last 10 years, and this is my attempt at understanding the following situation. Fine. And now you move towards the prerequisites, okay, that we're talking about such and such a theory, and the main concepts that we're going to be using are A, B, C, and D. Let me quickly remind you, like in the next minute, what those required things that you need to know are. You need to know this, you need to know this, you need to know this and this. Those are the main ingredients. And now here is what I've discovered. And you can illustrate it algebraically or geometrically, graphics, you know, anything that's visual is good. And at some point you should also, again, connect with prior work, you know, make at least mention, and maybe in the description of your video you can give some more precise references to things which are connected to what you're doing. Okay, so it should be concise. Don't go on about your life story. Don't go on about the heroics that has been involved in doing this. No one is really interested, I'm sorry to say, okay, except maybe your mother, okay, but you're wasting your time, and your readers or viewers are going to have very limited patience, and you can't impose on them too much. So probably I've already said enough, so to not impose upon you anymore, I'll finish this lecture trying to encourage you, okay, to move in this direction. The modern world is offering us a lot more opportunities to contribute by adding your voice to what's out there. And these search engines are great at finding things. So if you put something out there and it's nice, people will eventually find it. And hopefully if you can do this several times and create maybe a sequence or a library of interesting things, well, then so much the better. Then you're more likely to gain a following, and then people will start to identify who you are and respect you. Okay, so these are some tips that I'm offering you in a kindly way, okay, but it's not something that you should do lightly. It does require a fair amount of work.